he say? He says, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, don't participate in don't participate in fleshly lusts.
That's right.
Wait till your time comes. I'm going to laugh at you. So we cannot fight because these things war against the flesh. Amen. He says now, we are now heavenly citizens of the kingdom of God, and therefore we cannot participate in the activities of this lost and dying world. Now when he says pilgrims, he says that this pilgrims, or he, the definition of pilgrim, is a temporary traveler who is merely passing through. He's passing through a certain territory on his way to a final destination. And we know what our final destination is.
Yes.
Just think about it for a moment. Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
That's right.
Now this is the attitude that believers must have about their present lives in this world. This is not the residence that we are that we should live in, but it's a residence that we're traveling through, or we're passing through.
Amen.
Amen. We can't get attached to the environment that we're in.
That's right.
Amen. So that's why it's important to live that a separate life, a holy life, a set apart life.
That's right.
Yeah.
Now see, it's interesting because he says abstain from fleshly lust. This is the area where the enemy can get a stronghold in our life.
That's right.
Amen. Now look at what he says again. He says, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, you're passing through. Don't get attached to this environment. He says, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul.
That's
the soul, the mind, the will, the emotion. The mind is the playground of the enemy. That's where he and his attack come. It's the battlefield. That's where all the attacks come. In the mind. That's why, number one, we should what? Renew our mind. Number two, meditate day and night on the word of God. So that when the enemy does come with his attack to the mind, we can resist him.
Yes, amen.
Amen. The Bible tells us to resist the devil and he will flee. But if you have nothing to resist him with, you can't resist him with a shotgun. You can't resist him with knives. You've got to resist because it's what? A spiritual warfare. So you've got to stand against him in the spirit. And the only thing that you can do is use the word of God. He says, Paul says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God,
pulling down strongholds.
And so you've got to spend time pulling down strongholds. You've got to spend time reminding the devil that he no longer has property or authority over you. You've got to spend time speaking God's word out of your mouth, reminding yourself and the devil that you are the righteousness in Christ Jesus. You've got to spend time to me. You've got to spend time letting the devil know that you've been redeemed from the curse of the law. Amen. You've got to spend time letting the devil know that he has been rebuked. Why? Because you're obedient to the will of God. You're a child of God. The blood of Jesus is over you. The redemptive work of Christ has been worked out in your life. That's good news. That's good news. The redemptive work of Christ is a reality in your life. But if you don't take hold of it, the devil will wear you out every day of your life. Amen. Where does he play? In your mind. Look at what he says now. Peter says this. He says, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the what? The soul, the mind, the will. Tells me it's a choice. Your will. That's a choice. You choose. You choose to submit yourself to the word of God. You choose to submit yourself to the works of the flesh. You choose. Amen. It's up to us. So now, this attitude is the attitude we must have living in this present day world. Again, we're not in this, we're in this world, but we're not of this world.
Yes.
So to participate in the lust and the corruption of the world and say we're believers,
yes,
it won't work. You can't have one foot in and one foot out.
That's right.
You're either in or you're out.
Good word.
I'll say that again. You can't have one foot in and one foot out. You can't straddle the fence. Man, I remember I had a 10-speed jacket. I sold Christmas cards to get this 10-speed. Finally got the 10-speed. Put the chain on wrong. You know that crossbar that hits right there? You got to straddle that bike to ride it, right? And that's how it is when we straddle the fence with the Lord.
Hello.
You slip and fall. You're going to hurt yourself. Unto death, just about. You can't straddle the fence with Christianity.
Hello.
You've got to be either in or out.
That's right.
And Jesus said to the church at Ephesus in the book of Revelation, he said to them, he said that you left your first love. He said that you pretty much buried what you used to do. You used to love me. You used to care about me. The church at Ephesus, that was the most prosperous church at that time. They say, history says that Ephesus probably had 100,000 members. The most popular church. Everybody wanted to be at that church. Everybody. If you could make it in Ephesus at that church, you were big time. And everybody wanted to be there. And so he said, you left your first love. Oh, you're prosperous. Oh, you're a fine church. You got a lot of people. He said to them, you hate those who claim to be apostles. In other words, those that came to that church, everybody wanted to be there. So if you were a preacher, if you were a minister of the gospel, that's where you wanted to be. And so people would go there with different glorious teachings and that sort of thing. And they had people, a board of presbyters, that sat and would determine who was really preaching this gospel and who wasn't. And it turned out that so many of them claimed to be apostles and they really weren't. And he said, well, you left. Yes, your first love. And sadly, that's what happens with us. We begin to fade. The things that we used to do, we don't do, we go back to doing.
Amen.
The things that we stop doing now, we're doing those things again.
That's right.
And in fleshly lust, it doesn't have to be sexual. It could be all types of things where the world, Satan begins to draw us back in.
Amen.
And now we're sitting wondering, what happened? Why am I'm not on fire for the Lord anymore? Why am I not seeking him anymore? Why? Because we've left our first love. You remember when you fell in love? Remember that? Bet you couldn't stay on the phone talking to Sister Allen, could you? You see her, spend time together, then you go home, pick up the phone and call. Stay on the phone an hour, 2 hours, then you snore. Right. Now you're on the phone. You're first. You're not. I'm not talking about Brother Jeremy. But you love. You love that person. You can stand not being around. Same with Jesus, but now we don't see him anymore. We've left our first love. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes.
But see, he says, abstain from fleshly lust. Don't do what the world is doing. Stay close to Jesus. He said now in the book of Revelation chapter 2, the church at Ephesus, he says, repent and turn to your first
love.
Repent. Isn't that beautiful? He didn't say, I'm going to dust you off and leave. But he says, if you don't repent, I'm going to take that candle from you.
That's right.
And so I believe God desires more of us. The world wants more of us, but God wants more of us. We've got to decide. We've got to say, yes, I'm going to serve you. Remember what he said. Look at this again in a moment. He says, verse number 11, behold, I beg you, Beloved, I beg you, sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, the mind, the will, the emotions.
Yes.
Renew your mind. Choose to serve Him. Put your emotions in check with the Word of God.
Yes, yes.
Amen. And don't allow this world to draw us away. Amen. We must refrain from all carnal levels and desires that try to drag us down. And they try to drag us down where? In our mind, in our will, our emotions, our soul.
Yes.
Amen. Now, when you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I quoted this earlier, go there. It was so funny.
I spoke on the same thing on my YouTube channel.
Just wait till you YouTube. All right, he says 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look at verse number 1. 2 Corinthians 5, verse number 1. You know what? Hold your spot there. I'm sorry. Go to Hebrews. Hold your spot there. After all, you need to go to your Bible, right? You need to. Hebrews. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hold your spot, 2 Corinthians. Look at verse number 8. Interesting. By faith, Abraham, Hebrews 11, verse number 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. Isn't that powerful? King James is not knowing where he went. So he didn't know where he was going, but he obeyed God. It says, by faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which had a foundation, whose builder and maker is God. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she was judged by him faithful, because she judged him, faithful who had promised. Verse 12, therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and innumerable as the sand which is in the seashore. Now here's what I want you to see, verse 13 and 15. He says, these all died, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Now what did they do? They embraced the promises of God. We should embrace and confess what God has said. And then recognize again that we are strangers, sojourners, and pilgrims on the earth. So your time here is temporary. Our time here is temporary. And there's a work that God has for us. So it's important that we don't get caught up in the corruption that's in the world. He said he's given us great and precious promises so that we can escape the corruption. Glory to God. So now, again, he says in verse number 14, he says, for those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Glory to God. And what's our homeland? Heaven. What's our homeland? The kingdom. Verse 15, and truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. What is your mind full of? What's your mind full of?
Look at that.
Is it full of the things you used to do? Is it full of how it used to be? Man, when I wasn't saved, I didn't have these kind of problems. Maybe I ought to go back. That sounds like the children of Israel.
That's right.
They wanted to go back. They wanted to turn around. Let's go back into slavery. And sad to say, some of us go back.
That's right.
Paul said to stand fast in the liberty in which Christ has made you free. And don't be entangled again
with the yoke of bondage.
So what does that mean, going back to the vomit? Going back to the way I used to do things? A sow, what is that, a sow? A pig going back to a slop?
Mm-hmm.
We don't need to do that. But we need to press forward. So he says, and truly, if they had called to mind the country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity
to have returned.
So we want to resist the devil and not return to the way it used to be.
That's
amen.
Right.
We may think it's so easy to return to the way it used to be, but we're going back into slavery. Now go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9.